Good morning, distinguished participants, my senior colleagues and colleagues from IDSA, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to have you all this morning. We didn't realize that we have already covered 10 summers or 10 winters, as you can say, while dialoguing about South Asia. We started it in 2007, and this is the current dialogue that we are going to have. In fact, it was scheduled in November 2016, but we are holding it now. I'm required to give you an overview of how this dialogue has proceeded over years. Let me tell you that, you know, when we started in 2007, we started with a lot of apprehensions that whether, you know, this will match up to the other calendar event that we have in IDSA. This is Asian Security Conference. But the argument in favor of organizing a conference like this was very, very powerful and very, very convincing as well. At that moment, we had a foreign service officer as our deputy director general who mooted this idea, and it came in the background of the recognition of the need to promote regional cooperation. There was a conscious effort to do this, because we realized by 2007, when India had decided to give a firm push to the idea of regional cooperation, that it's not going anywhere because of a lot of issues, and that required a dialogue among different stakeholders in South Asia. We were very much aware that as a region with 1.75 billion population, with 2.89 trillion dollar economy, the regional intra-regional trade was less than 5%, and this is something that was always rankling in the minds of policymakers. And at that point of time, we thought, as a think tank, it was our duty to initiate a track to dialogue discussing these issues. So it was a very, very conscious decision, and this had the blessings of the stakeholders. When we started it, there was a fund raising issue, and we got some initial funds from the foreign ministry, and then the defense ministry owned it up, and from 2007 onwards, we are having an uninterrupted series of dialogue. And we were also encouraged to see our partners in the region. They were very, very encouraging in their response. When we started dialoguing with our partner institutes in the region, we found them welcoming this idea, and they came to our different dialogue forums with very open-minded, constructive suggestions as to how to strengthen this dialogue. And we are happy to tell you that we have sustained this interest over the years. And over the years, we have issued various, discussed various issues with a free, candid, and uninhibited manner. And we have shared the outcomes and expectations with the decision makers of different countries as well. Let me give you a glimpse of how we have gone ahead with this dialoguing process. To start with, in 2007, we discussed this idea of economic cooperation. As I told you, there was a conscious effort to promote economic integration of the region. And that is why the first ever meeting, we discussed economic cooperation for security and development in South Asia. And we had partnered with ICRIER for this conference, because we were utterly conscious that there were other institutes in New Delhi, like ICRIER, RIS, who were doing substantive work on this field. So we didn't want to match them in their with their expertise, because our this was not our domain. So we partnered with them to showcase this effort to have a dialogue on economic cooperation and security cooperation as well. So, and this came out nicely, and there were a lot of kudos from different stakeholders that this should go on. And in 2008, we came out with another dialogue, Changing Political Context in India's Neighborhood. This came in the wake of democratization of the subcontinent, of the region. In 2008, Pakistan reverted to democracy. You had democracy in Bhutan, multi-party democracy in Bhutan. You had multi-party democracy in Maldives. And that is why we thought, let us also flag this point. And there was also this theoretical issue that, you know, the concept of democratic peace, that if there is more democracy in the region, there will be more peace and less conflict. And that will provide the backdrop for constructive dialogue. And this dialogue also went on very well, and all our participants who came from different countries, they also discussed this issue of the increasing democratization of governance in different countries. And most of them said that this is going to be an irreversible process. And till date, we have democracies of different kind in the in different countries, but at least the process has been sustained. We have democracy. Maybe we have not measured up to the standards that we set for ourselves, but it is encouraging to note that we have been democracies, and perhaps that has given rise to a pious hope that there will be less conflict in this region. 2009, this conference was conference took place in the backdrop of this 26/11, this conflict, this Mumbai attack. So we didn't want to focus on that as much as to pose a question whether in 2020 South Asia will lean towards cooperation or conflict. And we had very contrasting views, but it was also a very fruitful exercise at that point of time. In 2010, we focused on terrorism as the challenge of terrorism, the common challenge of terrorism, and the prospect of regional cooperation. And if you see, the themes were interrelated, and the primary emphasis on finding different facets of cooperation, to encourage different facets of cooperation. In 2011, we focused on cooperative security framework in South Asia, and this had our stakeholders had evinced interest in this idea. And when we shared the outcome of this conference with our stakeholders, they were very happy to note that, you know, there was at least people in the region, especially at the track two level, discussing the idea of having a common cooperative security framework. As you know, we have different approaches to security and interstate mutual suspicions and interstate conflicts. They inhibit the process of cooperation in the region. But during this conference, we flagged some interesting points. You know, as you know, the idea of cooperative security is very old as the Helsinki Declaration of 1970, when this idea was floated. And this was basically held as an idea which will reduce the probability of conflict in the European context. We thought, you know, the cooperative security that we would have in mind in South Asia will be slightly different, in the sense that by 2011, this idea of defining security in a non-hard security, focusing on non-hard security issues, soft security issues, will be more, would be more profitable. And during that time, we talked about the need to have mutual trust. We should have transparency in order to have cooperative security. There should be respect for global norms, and the states of the region should eschew zero-sum approach to security. And we isolated some areas where, you know, you can have this cooperative security dialogue without undermining the need for dialogue on hard security issues. We thought there are other areas where, you know, there is less conflict amongst the different countries, and those issues can be taken up, and convergence of interest on those issues will also enable the atmosphere for dialogue on hard security issues. The identified areas were climate change, food security, healthcare, education, skill development, river basin management, science and technology cooperation, space and remote sensing, pandemics, and also the need for having institutional frameworks to push the idea of cooperative security. And this was received well by our stakeholders. In 2012, we again came to the idea of growth and stability in South Asia. In 2013, we covered a very interesting topic, which was regional perceptions about India. And it was very worthwhile to, consider this. And there were a lot of participants from the neighborhood who came out with their own perceptions of India during the conference. I remember one of them said that India is behaving as a big brother. Someone else said India is a big country with a small country mindset. So there were it was a very free and candid exchange of views. There were others who said that how can we talk about perceptions when we know so less about each other. There was a need for intercultural learning. This is what, you know, they started saying. And basically the book, which if you get it in the, access it in the web, I think it's a very it would be very educative for citizens of South Asia, if you can put it that way, to find out how the countries in the region are looking at each other, because we are still infected with that virus of Westphalian state sovereignty centric state system, and that is what is conditioning our mindset and conditioning our views about each other. So that was very worthwhile. And 2014, we discussed media and its role in promoting regional cooperation. That was also very engaging. We had people from the media also discussing these issues, people from media from different countries, and most of them agreed that media was both a disabler and an enabler as far as regional cooperation is concerned, and interstate cooperation is concerned. And there was a need to bring in media freedom, but not at the cost of irresponsible dissemination of news. So, because as we gathered, the media, people from the media were most critical of the way media was conducting itself, and the way they were covering different issues in South Asia. There were issues of paid news, like media conforming to the governments. There was the talk of how governmentality is infecting media. So this is a very interesting debate that we had. 2015, we came back to culture as a factor in regional cooperation, where we explored the reasons why, in spite of this rich historical and cultural linkages, the states in South Asia were unable to carve out a common cultural outlook, common security outlook. This was also very worthwhile for us. In 2016, as I said, we are now focusing on connectivity. As DG will take you through this idea, you know, of connectivity as public good, you will learn more about our approach to connectivity in this conference. I can only preface I think his deliberation by saying I don't want to encroach upon your space, sir. So I'm just saying that we were So we are basically looking at connectivity not as a infrastructure or physical connectivity. We are not focusing on physical connectivity. We are aware that connectivity has multiple facets like physical, socio-cultural, political and economic. And we are focusing more on the non-economic aspects of connectivity. We understand that it has different facets and we have to find out a way of enhancing connectivity which will contribute to regional integration and regional cooperation. As we are all aware, it will also feed into the efforts by SAARC. SAARC has laid special emphasis on physical connectivity. It's committed to establish a South Asian Economic Union by 2020. And in 2014, in the Kathmandu summit, it was discussed well, and where the countries renewed their commitment to substantially enhance regional connectivity in a seamless manner through building and upgrading roads, railways, waterways, infrastructure, energy grids, communications, and air links to ensure smooth cross-border flow of goods, services, capital, technology, and people. It couldn't have been phrased better. The point is to bring in connectivity in all its dimensions. And I think most of you have got the booklet now where we have raised certain questions and we are seeking answers to them. In fact, in this conference, we are also discussing an important issue, the issue of the security agencies and their role in enabling or disabling connectivity. We understand that there are security related issues, but our argument is that instead of security issues trumping this process of connectivity, we can take into account their concerns and move ahead. The questions that you are asking, as you see, let me restate them. I will conclude with that. The questions to which we are seeking answers are, how is the idea of connectivity perceived by South Asian countries? What are the shared benefits of connectivity? What are the main constituencies advocating upon South Asian connectivity? How are South Asian countries responding to various initiatives taken to promote connectivity under the cluster of trade, transportation, information and communications technology, energy, tourism and pilgrimage and people-to-people contact? What are the key challenges to operationalizing efforts aimed at enhancing connectivity in the identified clusters? What are the specific ways in which the challenges to regional connectivity can be overcome? During the course of the next 2 days, we will be indulging ourselves to find out ways and means of overcoming these challenges. I wish you all a pleasant environment here, and I hope the deliberations will be to our mutual benefit. Thank you.